The COVID-19 crisis has left investors in an unfamiliar landscape, searching for answers. You can find them by ordering your virtual Strategic Investment Conference Pass today. Over 40 world-class presenters and panelists offer their insights into how to make money in the markets. Secure your virtual SIC 2020 Pass today by clicking on the link below in the description.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Roth, and you're watching Malden Economics. I'm joined today from Germany by Rajeev Dutt. He's the co-founder and CEO of AI Dynamics. They are an artificial intelligence startup out of Seattle, and they work with clients like Dell, Sumitomo, and Takeda. Rajeev is quarantining with his wife, who's a physician, just outside of Dusseldorf in Germany. So Rajeev, I just want to get right to it. Back in mid-March, the Wall Street Journal published an op-ed by Andy Kessler titled, "Crisis Means a New Business Era." And this is the key line that I took from it. Kessler wrote, "I think the next tech era will be driven by implementation of AI-infused systems into every business." So Rajeev, within this context, how has COVID-19 impacted companies like yours?
Well, to be honest, from our perspective, we're actually seeing an increase in demand, which is kind of an interesting thing. It's like we were expecting to be even heavier hit, but no, that's not the case. Every one of our customers who started with us is continuing, so nobody's kind of withdrawn an agreement or something like that. Things have slowed down a little bit because of coordination issues, because everyone's out of the office and so on. But overall, what we're finding is a much faster uptake of what we're doing. In fact, some of the, mostly in Asia, so we're seeing a very, very strong push in Asia. But for example, recently, one of our customers, Dell, where they're basically pushing a sort of a Dell platform, we managed to actually get some acceleration, ironically, through this whole thing. So we're working on a POC that would eventually lead to us being on Dell-based platforms. So this is, interestingly enough for us, we see this as an opportunity. We're seeing a lot more interest in, especially, obviously given this current situation with COVID, an interest in bioinformatics and biotechnology is definitely a major area of interest. But then the other side of things is because one of the things that COVID has highlighted is our dependency on humans in factories. And one of the pushes that you're going to start to see more and more of, and we're already seeing that with one of our customers, is that you're going to start seeing increasing automation in factories so that the factories can function without the impact of a major catastrophe like COVID and so on. And it's pretty much like it's a catalyst for that. This is an ongoing trend. It's going to continue for cost and various other reasons, but the rise of the intelligent factory will be accelerated in the course of this this current crisis.
So the intelligent factory is I guess the moniker that's been labeled, that's been given to it, is it's Industry 4.0. And you obviously are deeply involved with that. And you're also involved with the pharmaceutical industry. Takeda, Asia's largest pharmaceutical company, is working with you. So on the pharmaceutical side, how do you see Takeda and other companies like them dealing with the virus, you know, from your point of view?
Well, I think currently, and this kind of shows you sort of the current immaturity of the AI market to date, which indicates the opportunity for growth. So right now, a lot of biotech and bioinformatics companies have had to fall back on traditional development and technology methods for kind of identifying drugs. The problem is that they're slow, they're cumbersome, and it's one of the reasons why this whole thing is taking much longer to kind of develop some sort of a treatment or cure or something like that. I mean, researchers are everywhere around the world are attacking the problem. I can't even count the number of organizations kind of focused on this. But even in spite of that incredible and enormous amount of effort, we're still seeing that it's running more slowly than usual. One of the things where I do see AI starting to accelerate, and it unfortunately will not help with this current crisis, but I do see, but I do expect that you're going to see further pandemics or potential pandemics in the future. One of the things you will see is that AI will increasingly be used in the development of drugs and also understanding the pathways that these viruses attack people. So for example, in the case of COVID, currently we know that it attacks something called the ACE2 receptor. And it is an RNA virus. RNA viruses potentially have a higher mutation rate and so on. So there's being able to understand the dynamic and what are the different pathways that it can affect the our bodies, which is a complex system, potentially is an AI opportunity. One of the things that our bodies, it is a complex system with a lot of feedback processes. You get some very interesting and really strange syndromes that are starting to emerge. For example, recently with kids, something like Kawasaki syndrome is starting to emerge there. You're seeing embolisms develop, you're seeing kind of vascular disorders and things like that. But these are all systemic issues in our body, and being able to understand that AI is great with that kind of dealing with those kind of problems. But right now, unfortunately, most organizations don't have a mechanism in place for large-scale deployment and large-scale use of AI. And this is precisely what we're offering, what we're bringing to the table, that if you start to use NeoPulse, we are basically empowering your entire research organization to start using AI. And it'll encourage a new mindset among the developers and engineers and biotechnologists to focus on data collection and high-quality data collection, which can potentially lead to faster development or acceleration of drug development and therapeutics.
Okay, so most of your work is with clients based in Asia. So, first off, Rajeev, why Asia? And second, do you think this might be giving you an advantage, as it seems like Asia is ahead of Europe and North America in terms of recovering from the virus?
I think, Asia, firstly, from the manufacturing side, Asia has about 38% of the world's manufacturing capacity is based out of Asia, which is an enormous amount. So countries like Japan, China, South Korea, these are the manufacturing giants of the world, and most of the products that come out into the world come from these places. So there's an increased push towards automation, streamlining of processes, being able to optimize supply chains. All of these things are incredibly important things, like real analyzing the current, like being able to predict failures and identify diagnose problems as soon as they emerge. All of these things become very, very critical, and because margins are extremely thin. So Asia, because it's such a strong manufacturing hub, the growth of Industry 4.0 is particularly strong there. The second thing is on the biotechnology side. One of the interesting developments is that a lot of Asian biotechnology companies feel that they are slipping behind, and that in order to accelerate the process of drug discovery and engineering, they are embracing bioinformatics probably at a rate that's faster than traditional Western biotechnology bioinformatics companies, who rely kind of more on traditional way methods. So a lot of Asian pharmaceutical and biotechnology companies are looking towards AI to see whether they can get a leg up on kind of accelerating the process. And traditionally, that's kind of been Asia's strength. It's the ability to adopt technologies. So when new technology is developed, usually Asia is one of the first places where you see wide-scale adoption of that technology. In terms of this current crisis, I think the fact that Asia is, by and large, becoming more stable, it has the advantage that people are returning to offices. Business is continuing kind of in quotation marks as normal. It's a slowdown, of course, but we are still seeing business being conducted. I think this kind of also it does insulate us a little bit. But what's interesting is that the lesson learned from Asian companies is that embrace AI even more strongly. And for example, we're talking to a Chinese automotive parts supplier right now. It's in the top 50 of the world's largest automotive parts supplier. It looks like we're going to be getting a contract in the near future. For them, this is a no-brainer. It's like this is kind of a way for them to firstly process information from car interiors, be able to provide better diagnostics and information about how people use the cars, better, like more to actually improve the overall driving experience. I do see that the same technology can be used, for example, in hospitals, can be used in the assembly line, can be used for employees in factories, and so on and so on. So I think what we're starting to see is that I think Asia, you're getting much stronger push towards adoption and potentially even stronger than what you're seeing in the US.
Interesting. Okay, well, you touched on it here just a few minutes ago. There is a persistent fear that AI will displace humans in the workforce. And given what we're seeing now with this unimaginable unemployment that's seemingly everywhere, at least especially in North America, do you see the potential for a backlash against companies that use AI, or, you know, what's your take on that?
Well, I think that if you look at where most of the unemployment is occurring, it's in kind of areas where I'd say that they're not likely to be impacted by AI to begin with. You're talking about bartenders, shop assistants, hairdressers, and people like that. This is kind of where the bulk of these people are affected. I don't see, firstly, AI being touching those areas anytime soon. I mean, I'm not going to get a robot to give me a haircut anytime soon. I would still prefer a human to serve me in a restaurant. And so I don't see that changing. Where we're seeing AI develop is in the factories and in some of the research sites. And again, it's not used to replace people, but used to accelerate processes. It needs to upskill humans so that humans start to make more, are more involved in sort of strategic decisions, involved in more tactical decision-making rather than doing something that's mind-numbingly boring day in and day out. What this does do, and where I do see an issue, is that the question is our education system up to scratch? Are we going to be abandoning these people, or are we going to provide them with retraining so that they can live in this world? And the demand for these kind of skill sets is just going to grow. Sure, you'll have an AI that's monitoring the factory and so on and so on, but at the end of the day, it's a human who has to make the decision. The only thing the AI will come back with is saying, hey, you know, there's a problem. We may need to restructure the supply chain or something, and you need to have somebody with enough knowledge to be able to do that. Every technology revolution has displaced some people, but it has often created more jobs than it destroyed. And a lot of times those jobs are more interesting than the ones that they destroyed.
So I want to ask you a broad question here about tech. And you've worked at senior levels of several major tech companies, Intel, Microsoft, HP, and such. What sort of tech company do you see thriving on the back end of this virus? And which ones do you think may not make it?
Well, I think that one of the things that obviously, the fact that we're talking Zoom, so communication and remoting based companies are likely to make it through. AI is probably going to be one of the areas where you're going to see much, much stronger development and growth. I think it's going to be one of the beneficiaries of this. I would say that a lot of the e-retailers are benefiting quite significantly. So companies like Amazon, obviously, and whoever else is involved in e-retailing. And I would say that the also some of the other areas where you're likely to see in technology, like technological development, is sort of co-location, co-hosting sites. And so companies that target those are going to be definitely benefiting. So those are going to be the technology winners. So productivity software, I think, is going to continue to grow. AI, obviously, is going to continue to grow. You're going to start to see an increased push towards cloud-based computing and work there, co-location centers and so on. The companies that are not going to thrive or not going to do so well are some of the kind of companies like rideshare businesses or Airbnb types of businesses and so on, who have traditionally been, who depend on people. And you're going to see, obviously, a massive drop in the use of these services. I think traditional manufacturing, you're going to see companies that are depending on traditional manufacturing, they are also going to suffer because of impacts to supply chains. Some of the hardware companies out there. However, I don't think computer companies are going to be impacted. So the ones actually producing raw computing devices, because the growth of AI just means that you're going to have more and more powerful machines. Those are going to go shipped to data centers and to cloud computing centers. But you are going to see an increased thirst for high performance computing hardware as well. So I see some advantage in on the computer side. But the big winners are, as I said, are going to be on the productivity side. But the sides that are sort of have traditionally in the last few years have come up, like the Airbnbs and Ubers of the world, I think you're going to start to see these companies are going to be massively impacted, obviously, by this whole crisis.
Hmm. Okay, final question for you, Rajeev. For investors, what sort of AI company should they be looking for in this new world that we're entering into? Because obviously there are different types of AI companies. Can you maybe just, you know, give our investors who are viewing this a bit of background on maybe what they should be looking for?
Well, I think the first thing that they should be looking for is a company that hedges some of the risks one of the challenges that you're going to see is a lot of companies are in very narrow verticals, which may or may not continue given the current crisis or beyond. So you have no idea where this is going to go. A lot of companies that are very highly dependent on retail or sales type of things like EPOS systems and those kind of services, those kind of AI systems will be badly impacted. What I do think is that it's a little bit like if you're building a portfolio of shares, you probably want some level of diversity. Well, if you're going to invest in an AI company, invest in an AI company that is able to do many things. So if a certain vertical doesn't work, then they can easily shift over to something else. And traditionally, the companies that can do that are platform companies. So if you look at the history of computing, platform companies have weathered recessions really well and have weathered economic downturns and instability extremely well. And I'm talking about companies like Amazon, companies like Microsoft, Oracle, and so on. They're almost independent of the economy. And part of that is that they hedge their portfolios massively hedged. So on the AI side, I'd be looking for a horizontal AI company.
Well, Rajeev, thank you so much for your time. My best to you and your wife in Germany. And
thank you so much.
Appreciate your insights today.
Great. Thank you so much and stay safe.
The COVID-19 crisis has left investors in an unfamiliar landscape, searching for answers. You can find them by ordering your virtual strategic investment conference pass today. Over 40 world-class presenters and panelists offer their insights into how to make money in the markets. Secure your virtual SIC 2020 pass today by clicking on the link below in the description.